So I will talk about making circumpolar languages as all as usual. As you, I think, all know, most Arctic, northern area of Eurasia were inhabited by nomadic or semi-nomadic groups. They maybe were not most numerous, so because sedentary peoples were usually have much more numbers, but in terms of area, nomadic peoples inhabited most of area in northern Eurasia at least. And in fact, it's easier to list non-nomadic sedentary groups for this region, namely Karelians, most Komi, Mansi, larger part of Hanti, south Selkovs, and some coastal people in the northeast, far east, Eskimos, coastal Chukchi, Etelmens, coastal Kalyaks, Aleuts, and also Europeans. There all other peoples of the north of the circumpolar region were nomadic. But their nomadic ways of life are really quite different, and it's possible to list at least three types of nomadicism, nomadity, of such lifestyles. Okay. Full or whole family nomadic pastoralism, when people migrate with all families and with herds of domestic reindeer. Such people are traditional Sami, Evenk, Nenets, Chukchi, Evens, Kalyaks, Dalgans, Enets, Komim, Ganasa. The other type is partial or male-only nomadic pastoralism, when only usually males of the or husbands of family or fathers migrate with herds of reindeer, and the rest of the family stay in the village. This type of lifestyle developed during Soviet times for almost all mentioned groups, except Central Eastern groups of Nenets. And quite different type of lifestyle is nomadic hunting and gathering. Sometimes together with occasional pastoralism, but often without any reindeer herds. This lifestyle is characteristic for forest Nenets and Nishans, northern Sirkup, Kets, Negidal, Yukagir, and maybe some groups of Evenki and Even. And as I said, during the Soviet period, many of these ethnic groups switched to mostly sedentary style of life, or semi-sedentary. But since we tried to create maps for all periods, we had to face fully the difficulties of mapping the nomadic ethnic groups. So, what are these difficulties? There are a lot of them. The first of all, it's huge areas of nomadic groups, and usually no clear borders between them. The second one is very low population density, and a very small absolute numbers of population in general. Normally we say about dozens of people for one group, and maybe hundreds or thousands for the whole people. It's quite contrastive to nomads in other parts of the world, for example in Africa, where nomadic groups are much more numerous. So it's one of the difference of northern nomads and the rest of the nomads in the world. The thought difficulty is high personal family mobility. Because one of you families, a group of families, could easily change their place, their pastures, and this could have serious impact on distribution area of the whole ethnic groups because of low obsolete number of population. The fourth reason is seasonal mobility. That was personal mobility, seasonal mobility, when different groups, different grounds used for summer and winter pastures, and migrations in autumn and spring between them. So each group had or have summer pastures, winter pastures, autumn routes to them, and spring routes back. Finally, the whole group mobility, because borders between different groups also change time to time, and the whole groups of people could change their place of pastures and so on. And this happened much more often than a change of borders between sedentary groups, naturally. It's not all difficult. There are difficulties. The winter pastures of one ethnic group could coincide with summer pastures of another group. So, for example, summer pastures of Nagano-san were on the same ground that Dolgan winter pastures. Or migration routes might pass through other pastures. For example, group of Yenisei Dolgans migrate to their winter pastures through area of Enets. The next difficulty is difficulty for mapping is multilingualism, widespread multilingualism, and sometimes unclear ethnic identifications for many groups, as Alessa already said. Because notwithstanding low density and due to high mobility, the groups had numerous contacts with each other and could speak several languages. Often we had serious difficulty to ethnic identificate these groups. For example, earlier Dalgans developed from such different groups that slowly switch their identifications. Or for example, group of Evena Yukagirs in Lower Kalamar region that switched their identity several times. And the last difficulty, the most serious, is it's not easy to obtain sufficient data on all this information, on all pasture areas, on migration routes, on coincidence of pastures and so on. Because traditional sources of information like census data naturally don't give us all necessary information because for census for example it's quite it's impossible to list all places of nomads migrate. So how these difficulties were solved or at least approached in some earlier maps in 19th and 20th century, for example. Let's see. In several maps of Siberia were created in 19th and early 20th centuries. They were not too bad, they were just too general. And the nomadic areas were shown with usually with solid color or stripe patterns. For example, this map of it's 1895, I don't remember this. You can see that there are just general big areas of one color for some with quite, quite artificial borders between some groups.
Another map from 1914, it's Marx Atlas, so called. It's much more advanced. For example, maybe it's too pale, but it's a part of northeastern part of Siberia, and you can see that I used solid color pink for sedentary Russian group, stripes for Yakuts and the Evens, dots for Karyaks, and visually nothing for Chukchi and Nikagir, only numbers like Roman 4 and 5 is Yukagir, Chuvan, and 1 for Chukchi area, but no borders of this area, no color for them. So, what was later? Later was earlier Soviet maps. In Soviet Union, ethnographic mapping cartography started to be created again after 1926 census, which gave a lot of useful information for cartographers. And the first map for the whole Siberia was Terlecki 1933. It's a big map of the whole northern peoples. It was the first one to distinguish clearly distinguish sedentary and nomadic groups by definite markers. For example, it's the whole map, and this zoom area, and you can see circles. It's for nomadic groups. Red one is Iven, sort of green for Chukchi, and this one for Yukagir. And squares for sedentary peoples, namely Yakuts and Russian. It's not clearly visible, the difference between them, but there is. If sedentary peoples were mapped quite thoroughly, for nomadic groups, of course, this way doesn't allow to act quite precise mapping, because of course nomadic groups didn't live in one area. They migrate the whole area, so it's some artificial maybe point where to plot such a dot. Excuse me. Then there was Boris Dalgich, who participated in the previous maps as a student, and then he developed the his own whole way of mapping of ethnic groups in Siberia. His most famous maybe map was map of ethnic groups in Siberia in 17th century. He used the method one area for one clan, родоплеменная группа. And there are hundreds of such clans for 19th century Siberia, and color differentiate according to linguistic groupings. So Topic, Ugric, Samoyedic, Yeniseic, Tungusic, and Yukagir, Kamchat. Later, for example, zoom area for northeast Siberia. And what distinguishes his maps, it's there are sort of gaps or wide area between different groups.
and it corresponds quite naturally to real distributions of such groups then. And later Dolgych used a similar methodology to create many other maps, notably the map of neighbor territorial groupings of peoples of the north for 1926, this one. And the main difference from 17th century map is that these groupings are much larger, but they are less, of course. In 1926 there were 356 groupings against, I don't count exactly, but twice more. These groupings in 1926, they include linguistically quite different groups, but which were close culturally or economically. And there are no more gaps between groups, and all surface of Siberia were covered by such groups. For example, and this is my vectorization of this map, and with using of colors. This examples of some other maps of Dolgych, which quite similar in methodology and borders of groups. Other more later Soviet maps, for example, Brook 1956, replaced representations of nomadic groups by a representation of sparsely populated areas. Of course, at first it largely coincided with nomadic areas. But decades later, when many nomads were made to became sedentary, areas of their former pastures became largely uninhabited. But on maps, those areas were and are still shown as sparsely populated on ethnographic maps. For example, it's map from Brook 1966, which you can see the legend that this stripes are sparsely populated areas, and just white area is uninhabited. Areas only place on the map of the Soviet Union, which was uninhabited, it was northern part of Taimur, somehow. But later, even this part, it's marked from maybe early 21st century. Even northern of Taimur became somehow populated by Ganasans. But it's maybe more advanced map, not Soviet tradition. In this, there is Taimur still uninhabited, and maybe more close approximation of real situation, such map where almost the whole of Taimur. Is uninhabited. Okay, what can we do with mapping of nomadic peoples and languages? What the main reason for such mapping is, for main reason of the difficulties, is the lack of sufficient data on their pastures and roots, and especially for the past. Where can we get such data? For some areas, there are detailed roots of seasonal migration. For example, it's a small part of Nenetsky Autonomous Okrug, and here you can see the roots of different reindeer groups, winter pastures, summer pastures, and so on. But such detailed maps exist. At least I can find such maps only for Nenets Autonomous Okrug. And there are more general maps of areas dedicated to reindeer enterprises. And you can see quite unusual stripes of land. And so here there are summer pastures, and somewhere here, or even in the Komi, there are winter pastures.
And for example, map created on base of such a sources.
If you can, here can you see which Nenets areas interchange with Komi areas, because some of this, here, for example, some of these stripes, in fact, belongs to Komi enterprises, not Nenets enterprises. And so when you create a linguistic or ethnic map, it appears that not all these areas are Nenets.
The other way to obtain such info is general maps of pastures in a certain area. For example, map of pastures in Chukotka.
You can see this a little more shaded area is reindeer pastures. Not differentiated between Chukchi areas or Iven areas or some other ethnic groups, just pastures.
In this example of map created on base of such source for Chukotka. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have time for questions.
I think there are some difficulties and problems besides what you mentioned in your presentation, not only connected with, you know, patients and many people, because you the title of your paper is mapping languages, but you were talking all the time about peoples. Is it a linear principle? You think that each people, each people has a language? Or definitely, it's not like that. And mapping languages is one thing, and we can, you know, figure out what principles we should choose, the distinction between dialect and language and so on and so forth. But with peoples, all these are names like Dolgan or Chukchi or whatever, Yukagir, they were introduced before when the ethnographers were preparing the first census in 1926. And that's one thing. And actually, people themselves, during that first census in 1926, they heard some of these terms for the first time. They were very much surprised when they were asked, I'm Dolgan or Chukchi, whatever. What do you mean, Chukchi? What is that? So actually, later they accepted them, of course. And they now, of course, they use it on a regular basis. They had, you know, all these labels in their passports, because at that time we had sort of a label in passports. And they remember, even today, what they had in those passports. And their kids do. They know about that. But how? With all these irregularities, that's the problem. And besides, one people, or at least one ethnic term, covering a certain group of people, sometimes it's kind of, you know, it can be related to two or even three languages. And some terms like Chuan, this term has at least four meanings, depending, you know, on what time you take diachronically, at least four. How do you think about, you know, all these difficulties, and is there any way to document it, to map it?
Of course, I'm aware of such difficulties. In fact, it's too much, too small, too little time to speak all of this.
For example, I used heavily the census data of 1897, the first Russian Empire census, which of course used a lot of clan names, not ethnic names, but названия родов, which not directly correspond to ethnic groups, related ethnic groups, but there are data on mother tongue in this census, for example, and it's clearly that the same clan, the same ethnic group, could use quite different languages. For example, in northeast, for example, Lamut or even clans that use Nifagir, and vice versa, and so on and so on. So, in fact, there are a lot of data which can be used. And yes, I generally speak about more about ethnic maps because creating linguistic maps needs much more work. For example, on these maps of Nenets area, the green border is the border of Nenets pastures, yes? And you can see here percents that show number of Nenets speakers of the whole Nenets population. And you can see, for example, here, zero. So this area of Nenets pastures, but no one speaks Nenets there. So if you if create a language map, this area shouldn't be Nenets area. For example, we have 2% or 1%, and it's quite difficult to plot this 1% on this area. Yes, but we know this. There are different shares of speakers from different areas. It's another difficulty, another problem for creating maps.
Yeah, I have two questions. First question is related to comparison between Eurasia and North America. In North America, they have a very entrenched and established tradition of linguistic mapping from the 19th century, and it's basically all the same. They always indicate a very specific language area with a strict boundary. I don't know how they come up with these boundaries, but they very rarely you can see any indication of nomadicism or sparse population or anything. So is the situation really different, or is it just a different tradition, or what do you think?
The only difference that I know of is that there are no reindeer nomads in North America. So all in America there is no domestic reindeer. Right?
But they try to introduce them.
Yeah, but not traditional. They're not traditional reindeer.
So all
nomads are hunter gatherers, which not characteristic for Siberia. How they produce these solid maps, solid areas for these peoples, I don't know.
Maybe there is some literature on that.
Maybe, but
I
didn't.
Yeah,
there are notion of traditional usage, area of traditional usage. How it corresponds to real area used by these people? I'm not sure it's exact correspondence.
My other question is about the notion of big sparse population. So so what is considered sparse? For example, if you compare, environment of what is outside of Amsterdam and what is outside of Moscow, it would be a very different situation. And when you go out of Amsterdam, you see residential houses wherever you are. But in the Moscow area, even though it's such a big city, you go 20, 30 kilometers out and you see just the forest. So what would be the threshold What would be considered really sparsely populated?
It's an interesting question. And it seems that when they produced first map of sparse, yes, brook, wait, 1956, it just used previous map of Terlecki, 1933, and replaced the nomadic circles with sparsely populated areas, because it corresponds very, very well. So I don't think that they counted how many people here or here. Just presume that nomadic are scarcely populated and so on. Maybe there are ethnography literature books, I don't know, some estimate, some counts of how many should be population to treat as scarce species.
Yes, the coverage.
But the density in such areas is really very low, like 0.002. Really sparse populated.
Well, more questions? One more? After this is just a follow-up comment. If you say that the correspondence of sparsely populated areas to nomadic areas is full, I would suggest that this is just a political reason that by 1956 there was a political decision that we have no more nomads because this is kind of old way of life.
Probably.
Just and they replaced the term and that's all.
Probably.
I mean, this is
probably there is some mention in the literature, yeah. And then it's fine, yeah.
Actually, I just have a very brief comment on those data from the 19th century you mentioned before. I wouldn't say that they're more reliable than Soviet, definitely not. And with you know, all this clan system, it's not more reliable, definitely. So it wouldn't work out, it wouldn't give you much help. And that's my position. To have several layers of this mapping that so kind of to present the diachronic character, the diachronic distribution, and if so, what period of time do you plan to choose? Kind of one?
Normally, according to synthesis, some sort of time, for example, late 19th century, early 20th century, and so on.
Synthesis. Completely unreliable.
No,
that's what I insist on.
Don't agree.
Censuses have nothing. They have nothing.
Late Soviet census, yes. But
they have nothing to do with academic approach. First of all, you cannot count. You cannot count identities, cultural identities, because they are multi-level. They are grounded. They depend on certain contexts, and you know, it's soft stuff. You cannot count. That's the problem. Because so, of course, I realize that you don't have any better material to start with. That's understandable. You count censuses. What do you find in censuses? First of all, censuses are very different. What they started in the Soviet Union under communists starting in 1926, it's one thing. What they had in the 19th century, those were not censuses in the proper sense of the word. Those were some calculations, estimation, whatever. Those were not censuses. They were unreliable from the institution. And most of they took into account religious creation or Christian, non-Christian, something like that. So these are absolutely different things. When you see censuses, which presume that they are the same type of things. No, they are not. That's my thought.
Was the question?
Yeah, but census is basically different principles. When communists ethnic principle, that's one thing. What we have before, I mean, the data we have before from the 19th century, it's a completely different stuff. But if you put it on the same level, it becomes only the 19th century, it was like that, then the 1926, it was like that. No, we counted differently in a different way.
And the only thing I can say that, of course, I don't use all the senses. This is just one of the social information, and we compare it with a lot of other academic sources, and much more often than not, these academic sources rather support census data than don't. Yes, descriptions of the progress, linguistic descriptions, and so on. So it's the reason why I use census data. Now I don't think. I have a lot of census data from very, a lot of censuses from 19th century, 20th century, Soviet area, and I can say it's because I compared a lot of data for different areas, and I see that the census is quite reliable. Yes, there are of course errors, there are problems with identifications, some other, and in late Soviet census there are much more ideological changes. Yes, but in late 19th century and 1926, there are not yet some ideology replacements. And after that, this sentence was used to decide some ideological changes.
Okay, I don't agree with you, but actually, there is no other data to have a starting point.
Thank you.